people who manage to escape from abusive religious groups, families, and personal relationships sometimes find themselves repeatedly falling into similar abusive environments. It can be extremely demoralizing. We ask ourselves, how did we end up here again? Adding to the confusion, some mental health professionals will insist the reason we find ourselves in this poisonous spin cycle is that unconsciously we're attracted to abusive individuals. Some secret part of us is actively seeking them out. We're told that on some level, we're actively looking for people who resemble our past abusers. In previous work, I've looked at some of the problems with appeals to unconscious processes. As I've noted, spurious claims about unconscious impulses aren't confined to the world of therapy. They crop up in the social sciences and social media. But it's in the therapeutic arena that bogus speculations about our unconscious motives are possibly most potent. Clients look to therapists for support and insight, and many clients can become extremely vulnerable to suggestion. For that reason, therapists need to exercise caution about the ideas they express and how forcefully they express them. Not all therapists do. Over the years, people have shared many personal experiences in individual or group therapy in which it was claimed they were bringing their misfortunes, their abuse, even their physical illnesses on themselves through their own unconscious wishes. Effectively, they were being told they had a double consciousness, two separate functioning minds. Beyond the one they were familiar with from direct experience, there was a second mind operating entirely outside of their awareness, hidden behind an impenetrable veil, a mind with its own separate desires and motivations. Like some unseen backseat driver, it could take over and steer them in the direction it wanted. Any conscious decision could be overruled if it conflicted with the backseat driver's agenda. When that happened, without even realizing it, individuals might start sidelining or sabotaging their intended goals to satisfy the wishes of their secret mind. Targets of abuse who were consciously determined to avoid abusers could be hypnotically compelled to seek them out in response to some non-conscious impulse. Maybe their secret mind still had feelings for a past abuser and wanted to find a substitute to help them reenact that relationship, hoping for a better outcome. Maybe their secret mind was haunted by a guilty memory and wanted to be punished. In the grip of this undetectable influence, individuals could then find themselves repeatedly sleepwalking into abusive relationships, or so some therapists would have them believe. Folks from certain religious backgrounds might spot a resemblance between this conjecture about the unconscious and conjecture about demonic possession. In both cases, there's an attempt to explain behavior by appealing to an inaccessible mind. Because of that inaccessibility, any assertions made about the motives of these supposed hidden minds are unfalsifiable speculations. Peddlers of demons are free to posit any demonic desire they like, and peddlers of the unconscious can posit any unconscious intention, all without any fear of empirical refutation. In both cases, clients are expected to accept their assertions based purely on fallacious appeals to authority. Their assertions are true because they say so. The concept of unconscious motives might appeal vividly to our imaginations. It can certainly make for entertaining fiction. Alfred Hitchcock revisited the concept as a central plot device in various films, including Spellbound, Psycho, and Marnie. But it has no place in therapy. There's a common misconception that therapy is about coming up with dazzling psychological theories, wildly inventive counterintuitive leaps. In fact, therapy is about straightforward detective work. Therapists and their clients form an investigative alliance. With focused attention, they work together to pick up solid practical clues and build them into an accurate, evidence-based picture that illuminates the substantive issues at play. When we ground ourselves in disciplined empirical investigation, big problems quickly emerge with the notion that cycles of abuse must indicate some underlying attraction to abusers. Many targets who've repeatedly found themselves in abusive relationships report that their abusers behaved completely differently when they first met. Often, it wasn't so much that they came as wolves in sheep's clothing. Many abusers were more like wolves behind mirrors. They appeared to like all the same things as the target, share all the same values. Whether the abusive parties were individuals or groups, at the start of the relationship, targets were presented with a reflection of themselves. The mirror would only be dropped when the target had been reeled in. So, were these targets attracted to people who reminded them of past abusers, or people like themselves? The evidence points unambiguously to the latter. The fallacious assumption repeatedly made by proponents of the unconscious is that if you keep having the same experience, some part of you must want it. But we don't have to look far for examples that refute this assumption. For instance, we wouldn't assume an individual who'd been repeatedly financially scammed by con artists was unconsciously seeking those abusers out. We wouldn't suggest there was some secret desire to reenact the original scam with a positive outcome. Instead, we'd recognize that the fact the individual kept getting repeatedly scammed probably meant there were ongoing vulnerabilities that weren't being addressed. Maybe the individual was too trusting or unaware of some important warning signs. We'd be looking to see how we might help build better defenses. And yet, when it comes to abusive relationships, for some therapists, the standard supposition is that targets of these con artists must be driven to replay the past. It's worth taking a moment to address a couple of straw man arguments that I've had put to me on this subject. Am I saying no one was ever drawn to individuals they believed to be dangerous or abusive? No. During his public trial in the late 1970s, serial rapist and killer Ted Bundy amassed a sizable female following. Many of them turned up at his court hearings. Some went as far as deliberately arranging their hair in the same distinctive style as Bundy's victims. Some believed he was innocent, but others had a more complex response. They believed Bundy was guilty, but also believed they would be safe with him. They imagined that, unlike the women he'd killed, they would somehow win him over. Am I saying no one was ever drawn to individuals who reminded them of abusive loved ones? No. Somebody I used to know married a man explicitly because he reminded her of her dead father. Her marriage became a replay of her childhood. The fights, the broken promises, the random absences as he disappeared for days. His failure to hold down any job, dragging them into increasing debt. She confessed that she struggled with constant loneliness, overwork, and financial hardship. But she said from the moment they met, it was like having her father back, and she didn't want to lose that feeling again. The fundamental point about Bundy's followers and the woman who married her father is that their attraction to abusers was conscious. They saw the menace in their midst and chose to walk towards it. That makes their situation entirely different from cases where targets are drawn in by deception and fail to see the menace. I want to present some real-life examples of individuals who were told they were unconsciously attracted to abusive situations. I'll be looking at how each of them pushed past that fallacious diagnosis and discovered concrete, practical answers that helped them break their abusive patterns. These examples also illustrate the huge differences that can exist between one target of abuse and the next. Different vulnerabilities, different response styles, and different reasons for tolerating abuse. As always, details are disguised to preserve anonymity. Adam was born into a family dominated by a malignant, narcissistic matriarch prone to violent rages. She nicknames him the clown and routinely threatens to send him away to the circus. At the same time, she does everything she can to stop him ever leaving sabotaging any sign of independence. Despite her efforts, Adam eventually finds a steady job and moves out. After signing up to a dating app, he's approached by Diane. She's like no one he's ever known. Kind, empathic, generous. Before he knows it, they're married, and her caring persona cracks. She becomes cruel and mocking, and starts flying into violent rages. Adam feels like he's married a stranger, but he stands firmly by his marriage vows, even when Diane begins to flaunt a string of lovers. Finally, she divorces him for another man. After the split, Adam is pursued by Fiona, a co-worker who supported him tirelessly through his divorce. Before he knows it, they're married. With nauseating déjà vu, he watches her kind demeanor dissolve into violent rages. Feeling devastated and trapped, Adam signs up for 6 sessions at a counseling charity. His therapist tells him he's drawn to abusive partners because he's looking for women like his mother. On a symbolic level, he's trying to win his mother's love. Adam says his wives were nothing like his mother before he married them, but his therapist says he would have picked up on their real natures unconsciously. He bows to her professional opinion. After 6 sessions talking about his mother, Adam emerges none the wiser. Still desperate for a solution, he decides to continue with therapy and engages a long-term private therapist who he's surprised to find takes a very different empirical approach. She explores 2 practical questions. First, what factors drew Adam into these marriages? Second, when he realized they were abusive, what kept him in these marriages? Together, they identified some of the actual issues driving Adam's abusive cycle. First, they acknowledged a simple truth. Adam was deceived. Both of his wives had misled him with a string of lies and misrepresentations. There was no substantive reason to believe some secret part of his mind had seen through their deception to their true natures, or made any connection between them and his mother. In looking at how he'd been manipulated, Adam recalled how overwhelmed he'd felt when he began seeing them. In the rare moments they weren't physically together, they'd be constantly phoning and messaging him. They blocked out everything and everyone else. At the time, he read their intensity as love. Now he could see how they were giving him no space to think. Adam also recognized he had a problem handling positive attention. It aroused a jumble of feelings. He enjoyed it, and it made him squirm. He felt grateful and obligated, as if he was being given too much of something, building up some kind of debt. He wanted to run from it, and wanted more of it. In this conflicted state, he felt constantly off balance. Many targets of abuse struggle with positive attention. They might flee from a compliment. This kind of discomfort can act like a signpost to abusers, reading, "not accustomed to being treated well." In the process of identifying these kinds of factors, the mystery of how Adam had found himself married to complete strangers began to make sense. This practical awareness also helped immunize him from future repetition. When Adam reflected on what kept him in these abusive marriages, his reflex response was that he had no choice. He'd made solemn marriage vows he couldn't break. Adam's therapist explored where this rigid thinking came from. Adam recognized his father's voice. From an early age, Adam had strongly aligned himself with his father, who he saw as the good parent, and aspired to uphold his values. A value frequently repeated by his father was never break a promise. Thinking further back, Adam could hear his grandfather's voice in there too. Both men saw divorce as something deeply shameful. Adam had absorbed these values as absolute law. Now he could see how they'd kept him imprisoned in 2 abusive marriages. In reassessing his father's values, he began to reassess his father. He used to see him as a man of superhuman integrity and patience. Now he just seemed trapped, straitjacketed by the same rigid, oversimplistic values he'd passed down to Adam. As Adam became aware of the actual issues driving his cycle of abuse, he was able to start addressing them. No longer feeling obliged to keep his marriage vows, he left Fiona. His mother tried to shame him over his 2 failed marriages. but Adam said he preferred to think of them as two successful divorces. Callie wrote to me a couple of years ago. She was also in her second abusive relationship when she entered therapy. Callie was raised in a religious high-control group that governed almost every area of her life, from social to educational to professional. When she began to resist that control, she was reprimanded. When she persisted, she was shunned, abandoned by her entire community, including all her family and friends. In the unimaginable desolation of losing a lifetime of relationships overnight, the single consolation she held on to was that she'd never be controlled again. In the grueling process of rebuilding her life from nothing, she met Sean. In no time, she was completely under his control. When he first began to take over, she made some attempts to stand her ground. When he didn't back down, she was horrified to see herself sink into compliance. She stayed with Sean for a few years before growing hints of physical violence drove her to secretly organize a new job and apartment and one day disappear. As Callie began to rebuild her life for a second time, she met Manny. This time, things would be different. In no time at all, they were the same. Callie engaged a therapist who told her she was attracted to controlling individuals because some part of her wanted to recreate her controlling upbringing. He said she equated being controlled with being loved. When Callie rejected this idea, he became insistent and told her she needed to face her desire to be controlled. As Callie noted, leaving a controlling therapist was a lot more straightforward than leaving a controlling partner. Callie found a new therapist who helped her identify some of the actual issues of the situation. The central issue was that since losing everyone she'd ever loved, she now had intense autophobia, a crushing fear of being alone. That phobia had various effects. Callie was constantly desperate for company. She was never unavailable, and always keen to stay a little longer. Callie's therapist noted her anguish each week when her time was up. This insatiable hunger for company left her extremely vulnerable to exploitation. Her fear of being alone also affected her choice of company. She tended to favor individuals who, like her, were always available. A big part of what attracted her to Sean and Manny was that they never seemed to want to leave. She could see now it wasn't a great basis for choosing a partner. Callie's autophobia severely compromised her boundaries and her standards. She said she felt like water around rock. Other people had all the power. She hated being controlled. She didn't equate it with love. But she endured it because being alone felt even worse. Callie's therapy was about becoming comfortable with her own company. Not quick or easy work, but it gave her back her power and broke the cycle. After leaving Manny, she found she was in no rush to get involved with someone else. For the first time in her life, she felt free. Finn's story illustrates the lengths some therapists go to confirm their assumptions. Finn enters therapy after leaving a malignant political group. It's not the first malignant ideological community he's joined, and his experiences follow an almost identical pattern. The first is an evangelical religious sect he's recruited into by some teachers at his school. The joyful buzz exuded by its members contrasts sharply with his dull home life, and he throws himself into his new community. But gradually, he begins to notice something's off. He discovers that various social prejudices are being promoted. Innocent groups are said to be demonically possessed. Finn throws himself into mending his precious community, taking a stand against these poisonous ideas. In response, it's suggested he's having a crisis of faith. When he continues to speak out, he's told he's possessed. Finn persists until, finally, he's expelled. Finn joins a spiritual healing group. It's an extremely supportive atmosphere, and he throws himself into his new community. But gradually, he begins to notice something's off. The leaders can be aggressively patronizing and infantilizing. Finn sees some of his fellow members regress into timid, compliant children, afraid to disagree with the leaders. He throws himself into mending his precious community. In response, he's told he has psychological issues. The leaders suggest he's disrupting the group because on an unconscious level, he wants to make himself an outsider, just like he did in his evangelical group. Finn persists until finally he's expelled. Finn joins a political group. The members are passionate about truth, peace, and justice, echoing his own values, and he throws himself into his new community. But gradually, he begins to notice something's off. There's a bullying, tribalistic mentality. Dissenting opinions are punished with verbal abuse and wild smear campaigns. Finn throws himself into mending his precious community. In response, he's labeled an enemy and a fraud. Finn persists until finally he's expelled. After listening to Finn's accounts, his therapist says what she's hearing is a little boy trying over and over to mend his own abusive family. Finn says his family wasn't abusive. To his bewilderment, she contradicts him. She says her experience tells her his family was abusive. She says his extreme persistence in trying to mend these abusive groups indicates there's something deeper going on here. She tells him memories of abuse can sometimes be repressed, hidden from the conscious mind because they're too painful. Finn insists his family wasn't abusive, but she won't have it. It was in that moment, fighting to be heard by someone he was paying to listen, that Finn saw the driving force behind his abusive cycle. He ended the session and didn't return. Sometime later, he found a name for that driving force. The sunk cost trap refers to our tendency to continue some activity or undertaking solely on the basis that we've already made some significant investment in it, specifically an investment we can't get back, hence the word sunk, meaning unrecoverable. The thing we invest in could be anything, a business, a relationship, an ideological group. The resources we invest could take various forms, time, money, effort, emotion. Finn had no reverse gear. He lived by the motto, "I've started, so I'll finish." Once he committed himself to something, he would see it through to the end, whatever it was. From joining an ideological group, to reading a book, or watching a movie. He hated the idea of giving up on any project he'd made some kind of investment in. It would feel like the chunk of his life he'd spent on the project had been a complete waste. Of course, the result of stubbornly completing every project he started was that he ended up wasting so much more of his life on unfulfilling enterprises than he ever would have if he'd just allowed himself to let go. Finn recognized that part of the reason he repeatedly fell into this trap was his tendency to throw himself into things impulsively on the basis of a positive first impression. He needed to ease in slowly with eyes open. But most importantly, if he began to notice something was off, instead of automatically going into mending mode, he needed to soberly assess whether to continue or end his investment. As Finn said, he needed to recognize when he was just rearranging deck chairs on the Titanic and jump ship. I'll end with Muna's story. Muna was a client I saw when I was working at a therapy charity. I took over her case when her previous therapist left the organization. Muna came from a large family dominated by an abusive father whose drinking and gambling left them destitute. He died in her early teenage years, and the children were split into different foster homes. Muna came to therapy in the aftermath of an abusive relationship with an alcoholic gambler who had leached off of her for months to sustain his addictions before disappearing, leaving her destitute. He told Muna that in life there were drivers and passengers. He was a driver. She was a passenger. In our first couple of sessions, Muna offered very little information about herself. When she did offer something, she'd pause and ask, "What does that say about me?" Each time I'd tell her I didn't know, and ask her what she thought. She'd say she didn't know either. Some months later, I found out my predecessor had been in the habit of overanalyzing whatever Muna said. Everything was given some interpretation. Muna had been waiting for me to do the same. As she realized I didn't operate that way, she slowly began to take up more space. She said my predecessor told her she'd let this abuser into her life because she wanted her father back. I asked if she thought that was true. She stalled for a long time and asked me what I thought. I gave the question back. Finally, she said no, she'd never wanted her father back. After another long pause, watching my reaction, she said she was relieved when he died. She said he terrified her. She remembered how some of her siblings managed to avoid his violent rages by running out of the house. But she would just stand there, rooted to the spot, and take it. She said she felt like a seahorse. She'd seen a documentary once about Chinese medicine. They used dried seahorses to treat all kinds of conditions. She remembered seeing a diver collecting the seahorses from the underwater plant beds. They did nothing to defend themselves. They just froze, like they were hoping they wouldn't be seen. They were easy pickings. That was how she saw herself, with her father, with bullies at school or at work. She just froze and took it. And it was the same with her recent abuser. She hadn't wanted anything to do with him. He just came in, took what he wanted, and left. If he hadn't left, she'd still be taking his abuse. Muna was stuck in a maladaptive freeze response. Like fight and flight responses, freezing is a survival strategy. In the face of certain threats, instinctively immobilizing ourselves can sometimes protect us from harm, but it becomes maladaptive when it serves to make us more vulnerable. Many targets of abuse become stuck in one fixed reflex strategy in response to conflict and threats. Always fighting, always flying, or, like Muna, always freezing, even when it works against them. Because of the automatic, habitual nature of these responses, it can be hard to move out of them. It can take lots of physical practice to build alternative responses into the individual's behavioral repertoire. Muna's therapy focused on cultivating the ability to take action to defend her boundaries. In addition to our sessions, she decided to sign up for some assertiveness classes. She found a great group and progressed in huge strides. She said she found assertiveness addictive, and she'd delight in reporting real-life incidents where she put her training into action. In our final session, I remarked that Muna was no longer a seahorse. She said, no, she was still a seahorse, but a seahorse who'd learned kung fu. Therapy is straightforward detective work. The therapist and client form an investigative alliance to examine accessible evidence and figure out together what's going on. Therapists who try to tell clients what their unconscious motives are violate that alliance by venturing into unsubstantiated speculation on bogus material to which neither the client nor the therapist has access. In fact, I consider the practice of making assertions about clients' unconscious motives to be a form of gaslighting. Clients are being encouraged to doubt their own mind. Thankfully, much of the therapy world has firmly distanced itself from these outdated practices. Sad vestiges from the infancy of talking therapy, when some astounding abuses were routinely imposed on clients. Adam, Callie, Finn, and Muna were all told they unconsciously wanted to reenact their abusive past. Not only was this assertion unsubstantiated in every case, it also served as a huge distraction from the actual issues driving each person's abusive cycle. It was only when they moved past that bogus assertion that they were able to start getting to grips with those issues. Breaking abusive patterns often involves becoming aware of things we're doing automatically, without reflection. Each individual here had distinctive vulnerabilities not shared by the others. The key to their respective recoveries lay in identifying and addressing the specific vulnerabilities operating in each case. With that knowledge, they were able to end their cycles of abuse. And I would encourage anyone to follow their brilliant example and ditch any therapist who tells you you're unconsciously seeking abusers.